Okay, so I've got a 14 RCAL generator that my wife bought with an automatic transfer switch, 200 amps. And she bought it because she wanted to make sure she had power. You know, she's got a home business and she didn't want to go without power for some of those reasons. So she bought this nice Kohler 14 RCAL generator and the automatic transfer switch here. And I guess the first question was which brand. I think any of them are good, but I've heard of Kohler again and again, so it's a brand I certainly know and trust. And anyway, but they're all good. Maintain them. So the way I sized it to 14 kW, which I'm using natural gas, that 14 is actually propane, it's a little more energy dense, but natural gas power output is 12 kW. And I have a two-story house, it's 2,600 square feet. And the way I sized it was this. This is a hot day in Texas right now. It's almost 100 degrees. It's in late August, you know. And I monitor periodically my load coming off my utilities. I'm near the meter, and here's the meter, here's the disconnect. And now I'm in my ATS. And this switch here is redundant, but you know, it serves the same purpose as disconnect. The reason I wanted to keep that disconnect there is to have something for the fire department to disconnect in an emergency. Anyhow, so you can see the amperage I'm drawing right now off of one end of the transformer out on the utility pole. It's about 39 amps, and this other leg I got 36. I've never seen this over about 45 with everything going. Lots and lots of stuff on, and I'm not hitting 50. This is a 50 amp output machine. So that's the way I sized it. And this is a big house, and I live in a hot climate. So, you know, and I have four, if you count window units, I have four systems. So I'll go over step by step how I did it. It was a do-it-yourself kind of. I had a licensed electrician check my work, and a plumber hooked up the gas, and a Kohler representative come out and check my work also and do the warranty paperwork, so I have that intact. So let me turn it around, show you what I've done. First of all, the trenches per the NEC. Now my NEC is a little dated, it's 2014, but I don't think it's changed. It's 18 inches, so I dug a trench 18 inches deep to get my power down, and that's what you see there. I'm fixing to backfill it, but I just want to do this video, show you the trench work. And then this is the gas line. Had a plumber come out and do it. And also, another thing that was nice about getting that done is my old gas pipe that was coming up the riser, so to speak, where the ground, where it came right out of the ground, was right about here. And the corrosion is always most severe in that area. So getting that replaced with the new riser pipe was nice. And also, I've got some lightning protection going to it, as well as a new subpanel ATS first disconnect. And then also, I have a generator disconnect. Before, the wiring in this house had some, you know, additions. There was some archaic wiring. This house was built in 1960. It's been long gone. But along the way, there was a little this added here and a little that added there, and I tried to consolidate that all into one sub panel box. So that's done. Now, as far as the generator itself, the base, I used about maybe 7 or 8 80 pound sacks of quickcrete. I did a little chamfer here before I poured the concrete to, you know, not have a sharp edge protruding to, you know, stub your toe or kick it. And I also tinted the concrete green to blend in a little bit once everything starts to grow back. And I also bolted it in 6 places. I used 5/16 anchors or a drill hole, and then I used some screw set anchors and then my screws in. That's really not to protect it from wind, but when the machine vibrates, you don't want it to walk. So that keeps it in place. And that's per the Kohler manuals, which when my wife ordered this, she thought it was going to be 4 or 5 months, and we thought we had time to plan it out, and it came in a couple weeks. So while it was on its way, I read the manuals online, downloaded in PDFs, and that's operating manuals and installation manuals. There's 2 different ones and spec sheets. I read all that stuff, and then when the machine came, it came with that type of paperwork inside, and I reread it and did the installation. So that entails the following: hooking up the gas. Now I'm running natural gas, so the plumber came out and did this tie-in there to the T. It's this yellow NiPack pipe. Replaced the riser, which was rusting, the black pipe, so that was nice. Got, you know, got some nice new lines going from where he tied in there at the T. And then it goes into a solenoid. Now there's a switch here that Kohler provides, and if you were to run propane, you can do that, and you know, it does put out a little more power. It's more dense fuel, it's heavier, and you have to put a different orifice in, I think, and you have to turn this switch. So that's one thing. You know, in Texas, in this part of Central Texas, we have a pretty reliable natural gas supply, so no reason to not take advantage of that. And so yeah, it runs off natural gas, and at maximum load, it's about 193,000 cubic feet per hour. So it would be 193,000 BTU, 193 cubic feet per hour, excuse me. So that's at max load. So I've got this set to exercise once a week, 20 minutes every Saturday. You don't have to do that, but the minimum that the Kohler operation manual recommends is twice a month minimum. But the reason I wanted to do it every week is because if there's ever an error code, I'll find out about it a little bit quicker. And there's never confusion of, is it this Saturday or is it next Saturday? So that's why I chose that. As far as the connections themselves, I ran an AWG number 6 THHN, which carries 75 amps. This machine puts out 65, so I'm exceeding the capacity and compliant with the NEC on that. And then I routed it about 27 feet or so into the ATS, and that's my power. Now, also, you have to, on these Kohler generators, you have to run power to it to charge the batteries. So I put the wrong size breaker in. It's in here. It's a single pole, and I've got a 30-amp breaker. According to the Kohler guy, that's wrong. If you're using some sort of accessories like heater for a cold climate, Texas doesn't have that, but if you were, you would want a 20-amp breaker there for that circuit. And the other end of that circuit ties in right here where it says utility. He said use a 15, so 15 it will be. I'll get that changed out. Also, the control wires are supposed to be per Kohler through a different conduit. So instead of routing, you know, where I have the power wires and the AC for the charging accessory circuit, I have a different route going there. I don't have that trench quite as deep. Here it's like 18 inches, here it's like a foot. But anyway, I've got not only the control wires too, but I also have the comm wires, which is a Cat 5E, I believe. And this here goes all the way to my Wi-Fi box, which is a long ways through walls, crawl spaces, and get to the Wi-Fi router. But that allows you to communicate with the on-cue Kohler system. And if there's anything like power goes out and I'm somewhere other than here, it'll send me a text saying, hey, the power went out, I'm on, and I'm gonna do my thing. So that's nice. So that's hooked up. And my control wires and my Cat 5E are going through this conduit, coming up here, and then I split out in this junction my Cat 5E wire, and then my control wire circuit is here. Now, back to the ATS, the other end that the generator feeds to, L0 is neutral. I had to look in the owner's manual to see that, so it's my neutral wire. This is one load, this is another, and then it's my ground. Now, I had an electrician come out and look at my work, and he said, hey, disbond your subpanel box here. So I did, I took the bonding bar off and put the bonding screw in. And the way I tested that is I kept those disconnected here. I tested for continuity using, you know, the ohm control on my multimeter with it disbonded. And then when I bonded it back at my first means of disconnect, which is my box here, when I made that attachment, then I tested it again to ensure that, yes, indeed, they were disbonded. Same thing here. This ATS came bonded right here, neutral to ground, disbonded it here. So per NEC, you've got to be disbonded or your ground has to go back to the main circuit. If you don't do that, you're not compliant with the code. And what that means, there's a practical reason for that. You don't want to share your return circuit on your ground. You want all the return to go back on the neutral wire, not to be shared with the ground. And if you don't disbond it, other than your first means, that happens. So it's not safe. It's not good with code. Don't do it. And I didn't. So bonding's all good. I tested to make sure my disbonding here in my subpanel and here my ATS is all good. Ensured it's all good. Used wires that exceed the carrying capacity as required and came out. And the only thing that the Kohler guy said that, you know, was wrong with the way I had it hooked up was I didn't follow this sticker here right on the control wires. I thought A was right there and B, but it's actually shifted a little bit. My A is right here. So he fixed that and then ran a test. And then the other thing to consider is, do you have enough gas pressure to keep the generator within spec, which is, you know, on the scale of inches per inches of on the water column or ounces per square inch. So I've got a gauge hooked up so we can test that. Now, the way I can do a simulation on the generator here is just to simply disconnect the power. Now, I'll show you what I have real quick. I'll get the multimeter back on using the inductance probe so I can test the amperage and see what I'm drawing right now. I do hear that I have two big heat pumps going, or air conditioners. And right now, I'm drawing, looks like, on one leg about 12. So the big heat pump cycled off and that's good. So there won't be a delay. Okay, so I've got about 23 amps. So there won't be a delay when I do my generator test. And the way I can test it, and oh, also by the way, I did label utility disconnect. So that's clear to the fire department. And also when you have a generator, I don't know if it's NEC, it's in the NEC yet, but it probably should be. You wanna have a means to disconnect the generator. Because in the situation of emergency, say the fire department is out and they need to de-energize the house, well, the only way they can do that is turn that off, but then that comes on and then they have to have a way to kill the generator. That's more convenient than like an axe. So this is for that. If you want to kill the generator, throw that switch. Probably better to have one outside, but I already had this, so I just reused it. So let's give it a test. Right now, on one of my legs, I'm drawing about 20 or so amps. We'll go ahead and cut the power. And now when the power gets cut, the generator lights will change. It's saying, hey, you have no power. And then this light. Now I'm loaded here. And since it's loaded, the generator's not going to start up and tell me it's got power. Now, the thing to look at here is to make sure we have enough gas pressure. And this is supposed to be around 5 inches or so. I just barely have it. Now I'm good. Now I've got a little more than 6, which is where it needs to be. That's why I think you heard that little bit of a clunk, clunk, clunk. It wasn't quite getting the fuel. But there's also a solenoid there that's going to go off and say, okay, yeah, I'll open up now and give it the fuel. So I'm getting about 7 inches or so, which is where it needs to be. Now let's look at the draw again. Disconnected side of the switch. So to get a load reading, you're gonna have to go to the bottom. And this is what the generator is now gonna be producing. AC is off right now. If it was on, it would be giving more than 10. So when the thermostat in the house decides it's time for AC again, that's gonna come back on. And while we're waiting for that, 13 amps there, one leg, about 6 amps there on the other leg, and on the neutral return, we've got about, looks like 7. So we're a little bit unbalanced between one leg and another. 7 is going to be the difference. I'll show you the communication line to the Wi-Fi, kind of a long route right here, and then it goes through this atrium here, goes through some walls, and eventually I get to the router. So this is now let's do a simulation to get the power back on. AC hasn't come back on yet, but it could be the part of the thermal cycle in the house where it's cooling up, and I don't want to wait for the thermostat to say, yeah, go. But you saw before, I was drawing about 40 amps. This generator is capable of putting out 50. So it's fine for what our day-to-day life consumption is. 14 kW is plenty good for us. Anyway, now, so I'll simulate turning the power back on. Here we go. About 7 inches of water, which is enough. Total spec is 5 to 11 inches, so I'm okay there. So now it's gonna take its cool down, do its thing, disconnect, switch there, and also at the same time, I've received some text notifying from the Kohler on-cue system, notifying me that, hey, I came on, heads up, there was a power outage, we lost utility power, and I'm doing my thing. So all in all, the generator cost was around $4,200 or something like that, $4,300. My wife bought it, I didn't. I just told her what brand I preferred and what size. And I told you how I got my size. What else? The plumber was a little north of $1,000 to come out, and he dug a trench and put in his line. And also he, you know, tapped in on that T and put a new riser. So I fixed the rusty black pipe that was coming up out of the ground. That's a good. The electrician that I had looked at my electrical work, he's licensed. He gave me a trip in 1 hour. I think he was 200 and a little over 200. And then the Kohler guy came out and he was 300, and he signed off on the warranty work and he fixed my comms wires. So add all that up, 300, 200, 500, 1500. And then another probably 500, 2000 in wires and parts and conduit and whatnot. So 2000 and 4,200, 4,300, so I'm 62, 63, something like that into it, which, you know, saves some money not having to pay someone to come out and turnkey this. That's fine. And now, since it's gone through its cool down cycle, it's off and it's ready for the next test or power outage. The way I set it up is to have the exercise run unloaded. You can't set it up to run it loaded. When the Kohler guy came out, he communicated through this port right here to his laptop. He put all the settings to the way we agreed to. We checked the pressure when he was here of the natural gas. It gives about 7 inches or so. And, you know, this Kohler spec is between 5 and 11 inches of water. So good on that front. The battery does not come with the machine. So the local Walmart had this. It's a spec battery, 500 cold cranking amps, 51R for reverse, positive, negative, the usual thing. Overall, I would say it's a pretty easy install, except for getting that Wi-Fi Cat5 E wire all the way to your Wi-Fi router. That's not easy. And digging this, that's not easy either. In Central Texas, we've got some fat clay soil to dig through, and that's not easy. But other than that, everything is pretty easy, I would say. Getting qualified people in behind you is paramount. If you can do this yourself, that's fine. If you do it yourself, but get someone in behind you, you know, that knows what they're doing and catches your screw-ups. Like, I had the control wire screwed up, got caught, got fixed, no issues, no dramas. And yeah, that was it. I hope this was informative, and I hope, you know, if you do install it yourself, that, you know, you do this same thing. You get someone in and have it checked over, or if you know what you're doing, I guess you don't need to do that, but I didn't know what I was doing. I've never done this before, but done it now. So hopefully that was helpful and informative. Thanks.